Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, there should be a major distinction between those that love Him and those who don't.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Those that are baptized in the fire of the Holy Ghost and those who are not. We are not called to fit in. We're called to come out. And to be separate from the world. That doesn't mean necessarily in dress, but in lifestyle. That we don't participate in the pleasures of the world. Because our pleasure is in His presence. Because He is our pleasure. And our joy comes from Him. That's why the world can't take it away. Because they didn't give it. And no matter what life throws at us, the joy never subsides. Because we stay in His presence. Now you get out of His presence and the joy subsides. But we stay in His presence because that's where it all comes from. That's why Moses said, is if your presence doesn't go, I'm not going to be there. Because everything we have need of is in His presence. And His presence isn't limited to just the four walls of the church, like many think. Understand something. Understand something. The Holy Ghost did not come with wind and fire in the upper room to be limited to the upper room 2,000 years ago to 120. He exploded on the scene. 120 were baptized in fire, went forth in that fire, and an unbelievable, undescribable display of the glory of God was manifested. Signs and wonders and miracles were wrought by their hands. God did not start the church that way for the 21st century church to be signs and wonderless, fireless, no longer preaching, that's unctioned by the Holy Ghost Himself that men have given themselves fully unto, to be motivated and dominated today, the 21st century, by motivational speakers.
Right.
We are the same church. The same fire that came in that upper room is the same fire that's here now.
Yeah.
It's the very same fire that came upon me in 1990. That's all I can say about it right now. Yet it's still present to this day. And it's amazing how the church has allowed ungodly men and women who don't even know the Bible to dictate and control how the church should be. And it's happening all over America. But there are those that were born and birthed in the fire of the Holy Ghost, who has not compromised and will never compromise if it cost us our death. Before, we are here for one purpose and one purpose alone, to obey the Father, to hear from the Father, and to be His instrument for His glory to spread. and for the multitudes to be touched. Not because they're left with a stimulating thought, because they meet and encounter God. But yet you cannot have an individual meet and encounter God if you haven't. I remember I had a Presbyterian pastor who pastors a very large Presbyterian church in the South. Very wealthy church. And he said to me, actually came to one of our meetings. We had one of our revivals in Greensboro, North Carolina. Harry Supreme and Chefrey. I just, so much going in me, right? I don't know. Salamosota. I just seeing some stuff. Just, ha, mama, 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 ele bosa. Ha. Sheesh. I honestly feel like I need to go into a phone booth and just Superman come out. I feel it. I just want to grab somebody and just shake. So he came to one of the meetings where the pastor said to me, and I was at the church because he saw me on video. And I happened to know his son. And the pastor wanted to know if I would fake anything. My wife would tell you, I am not a faker in any way, shape, or form. I mean, I'm not, listen, you better know, if you see me dancing, you better know it's the Holy Ghost that's on me. Some people just got a flow. I can't even clap on beat, let alone do that. So, but you better know, I mean, you see me dancing because the Holy Ghost. And you know, there's a difference. And there's a difference in just doing the charismatic jump up and down thing, which is fun, but yet there's a difference between that and then when the Holy Ghost gets on your feet. Yeah. I can't explain it except it's like your feet's talking in tongues. That's the only way to describe it. And I feel like, whoo, Ramasista, Ambara. Ooh, Rasaka, feel it right now. Listen, do not sit there and the fire of God on you and sit in your seat and just do like that. No, take off. Because here's the thing, here's where people miss it, is that you won't step in until you yield. It can be all over you, but you got to yield. And in what God has for you only comes when you yield. See, because when you yield, you'll be filled. When you yield, you'll be healed. When you yield, that which God has for you will be released through you. But it won't happen just because you sit there in your seat and just dancing in your seat. No, you got to yield. Shakarabasite. You got to yield. Say yield. No, it's all about yielding. You got to yield. No, you have to yield. No, you have to yield. No, you've got to yield. Because it's here. You just got to yield. No, you've got to yield. So, anyway, the pastor saw me on the video. And he said, would Richard fake anything? He said, no, not the, he calls me Ricky. And he said, not the Ricky I know. He said, well, have him come to the church. So I came in, and he said, I want you to do Wednesday night. And I don't do one night. I mean, I'll do one night if I've been to the place or if I know the place is Holy Ghost. But I don't do one night. Because we could come and we just don't do one night. The places I've never been. But the Lord said, go. And so I go to the place, and we're having lunch, and this pastor says, well, I think you set people up. I said, what? I set them up? He said, I'm going to give you the Wednesday night, but if I see that you're setting the people up, I'll get up and I'll stop your service. And I'm like, I didn't say really anything to him. It's just that, hey, I don't do that, but because the Lord told me to do and go there. About, I don't know, a half hour, 45 minutes into the service on Wednesday night, which he taught on eschatology, and it was the boringest, driest. Oh, my God. It was horrible. I mean, is this horrible? I'd rather go have a root canal than listen to him talk about this. It was bad. I mean, is that bad? It's like, please spare me, Lord. Rapture me now. If you rapture me now, I'll never ask you for nothing ever again in my life. Just rapture me. Get me out of this stuff. I mean, it was just, huh, God, really? But, you know, when you're empty, that's what comes out. When you're empty, that's what comes out. And so about half an hour, 45 minutes into it, the fire of God started to fall. People started falling out of their seats, shaking. I mean, it was amazing. I looked at the pastor and said, I didn't do nothing. And I gave an altar call. Listen to this. There's about 150 people there. I gave an altar call, and over half of them answered the altar call on Wednesday night. So then he says, well, we want you to come and do a week. And then, so I go back for the week, and he said, we're not going to do morning meetings. I said, but I do morning meetings. He said, but we don't do morning meetings here. But I said, but I do morning meetings, and you agreed to it. He said, nobody will show. I said, that's fine, but I don't care who, just let me do morning meetings. So he gets up in the church, and he says, now people, he says, our young evangelist, and he made it a point that I was young. Our young evangelist wants to do meetings in the morning. Nobody's going to come. This is what he's saying to the church. There's about 350, 400. He said, none of you is going to come, but he wants to do them, so we're going to accommodate him. Oh my God. That's what I got to get up. That's after. Well, you know what? By the end of the week, we had almost 300 people in the morning. Not quite 300, but it was close. It was two something. We started with 400, 350, 400 people. Come at the end of 4 weeks, is about 1,500 people. People from all over, about six states coming. And for the 3 weeks, I fought. I mean, I didn't fight, but he fought with me. I mean, it was just everything he tried to explain away. And I'm like, Lord, why am I even? I want to leave. But the Lord said, no. I mean, then the third week, he calls me in the back. I mean, he's got his own doctorate, theologian, and so forth, so on. And he calls me, and before the service, the place is jam-packed. The bottom floor seats 1,000 people. It's jam-packed. I mean, one night, almost the whole service, we just had testimonies of the miracles. Just miracles. And he says to me, still after 3 weeks, he says to me, and he reads me this letter. I didn't even understand it. I was confused. I didn't understand it. And he said to me, now, son, you can do with this what you want. He says, now here's what he said to me, exact words. He said, what you're doing in my church, this is what puts people in mental institutions. I said, no, this is what gets them out. Yeah. And he says, well, you do what you want, but just take a word, you know, take a word from a wise man. And so I got up, and I walked out the door, and I said to the Lord, here's what I said. Well, I better not tell you what I said because, well, it's not bad, but it's, well, I'll just tell you what I said because you'll be thinking, well, what did he say? I said, here's my exact words. I said, Father, I will not deny your glory. I will not deny you. I will not deny your presence. And I will not be persuaded by any means what this old fart says. That's what I said to the Lord. I'm sorry, but that's what I said to the Lord, because that's what he is. I'm just being honest. That's what I said. And I tell you, listen, that night, the glory of God. Oh, because he said to me, he said, because you're setting the people up, because you've had the same people. You've had one guy testify more than once. See, he's all in his head. Well, what happened? He got so embarrassed because the night before I had his wife get up and testify, and the fire of God hit her, and it happened to be the night that he invited all of his theologian buddies. And they was all sitting in the front row, and they stared at me. That night, the fire of God hit his wife. And he said to me, he said, they come to see what you're doing because there's got to be something that he's using in the meetings. No, I mean, it's some gimmick or something, like I'm, so, whatever. And you know what? You know what he said? This is later. He said, you know the thing that confused him that he did not understand? Because they watched closely. All's I did, his were the words, we don't understand why the people responded the way they responded, and the people running, the people getting healed, because all he did, because they said he didn't use great emotion, meaning, you know, I mean, there's some circles. I mean, if you're not running up and down and shouting and spitting over fast six pews, you're not anointed. No, seriously. And but none of that was happening. I'm just doing what I'm doing right now. Just walking up and down, just sharing the word. Just sharing the word, but they didn't understand. All I am is God's messenger. Because these aren't my meetings, and that's where they totally miss it. That's where people miss it. This is not my meeting. It's his. And I just happen to allow him to come and do whatever he wants to do, however long he wants to do it, say anything that he has me say, no questions asked, and care not about what people think. It's all about what he thinks. Because I would rather offend you than offend him. And what happened is the guy's wife got up and the fire of God hit her. And they had to carry her down the stairs, and it embarrassed him. But yet the miracles were, we had 498 people saved in 4 weeks. Now, I'm not saying that wasn't just the one time. That happens everywhere we go. And I'm going to get into why in a little bit. But during that revival was a Presbyterian pastor. I said all that to tell you about the Presbyterian. There was a Presbyterian pastor who came, and his mom that was in the church said, you have to come to revival. We're having a revival at my church. He said, he was living in Durham, North Carolina at the time. He said, Mom, every time you have a speaker in, you call and tell me we're having a revival. And I come, and it's nothing. She said, no, but this is revival. He said, Mom, but that's what you all said. No, 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 son, this is the revival. And you got to come. And so you know what? He came just out of honor for his mother. Just out of honor for his mom. Always honor your mom and dad.
Hallelujah.
Amen? I used to tell my daughter before I'd spank her. I only had to do it a couple times. Before I'd spank her, I'd read the word to her. And I'd ask her, I said, do you want to live long in this earth? Yes, Daddy. Well, the Bible says, and you have to obey your mom and dad and honor your mom and dad. And if you do that, you'll live long on the earth. You want to live long? Yes, Daddy. Okay, bend over. No, I'm serious. I quoted the word to her. And so he came, sitting in the second row. Same thing, I just walking up and down like I am right now. The fire of God hit him. Boom, he's in the floor. He's in the floor. And everybody's trying to look over, and his wife's getting hit. Well, what happened was there's a big church in town, well, actually in another town, a very big church, very wealthy church, probably the wealthiest church in Carolina. They happened to come because it was a Presbyterian church. They split from, they didn't go the way of the Presbyterian. I mean, they want the Holy Ghost. I mean, that's unusual for a big Presbyterian church, especially wealthy. And they were looking for a pastor who's going to lead them in the things of God. And they just happened to see this pastor, who's a Presbyterian pastor in another city, hit by the power of God. And they're thinking, this is the guy we want in our church. So he gets so touched and becomes good friends. And he said to me, he's still a good friend to this day. He said to me, he said, when I was in seminary, and he was the head of his class in the cemetery, or seminary, seminary. Actually, really is a cemetery where he went, because you know what he said to me? He said, Out of all the years I went there, what all the professors instilled into us, and he graduated top honors in his co-class, he said, Your main objective in whatever church you pastor is to leave the people. This is what they teach. This is what they teach. To leave the people with a stimulating thought. No. Now you understand why I said this morning that every individual who gets out of Bible school that gets behind the pulpit must be baptized in fire. Because if not, you get that stuff. Leave a stimulating thought. So he said to me, after the revival, because I was going to take a week off before I start another revival, he said, you mentioned in the service that you're going to take a week off. I said, yeah, I am. He said, look, I got a beach house. My wife and I have a beach house in North Carolina that sleeps 18. He said, look, I love to play golf. I heard you mention you like to play golf. He said, look, why don't you come stay at our beach house? It's a big beach house, and me and you will just get to hang out and talk about the things of God, and we'll play golf every day for the week, and our wives will go shopping. And he said, before he said anything, I said, okay, we're coming. Give me the address. So as we go to his house to go there, he says to me, when we get to his house, now this is after the revival's finished, we go to his house, and he says, why don't you go upstairs and change? I'm like, for what? Because we're going to go to the beach. He says, we're going to go to a picnic, and I told him you would come. So why don't you go change? Okay, I'll go put some more shorts on. He says, no, why don't you put some dress clothes on? Dress clothes? It's a picnic. So we get in the car, and so as soon as we pull out of the driveway, he says, well, I got to be honest with you. He says, not really a picnic. He says, not really a, it's like a potluck dinner thing. Okay. So as we go and as we drive to the person's house, his wife says, Alan, just tell him. And he says, I didn't want to tell you because I didn't know if you'd come to a bunch of Presbyterians. He says, but it's not really a picnic, and it's not really a potluck dinner. It's a Bible study, and you're doing it. I said, well, that's great. Why did you just tell me that? Well, I didn't think you'd come. Now, he hasn't gone to this other church yet. He's still in this one, which he said to me that his elders called him in his office and chewed him out because he went over. He's supposed to be done at 12 o'clock, and he went 12:01, and they chewed him out. And he said, but there's a remnant of people in this church. They want God. And so I told them about you, and so they're all in the house waiting for you. So I walk in the house, and as soon as I walk in the house, I mean, there's, I don't know what, 30 people just staring at me. And so we go and sit down, and they're just staring at me, and he says, now, Brother Richard, just talk about what you want to talk about. Talk about the Holy Ghost. I said, Pastor, can I see you for a moment? He says, sure. So we walked down the hall. I said, you don't want me to do that. He says, why? I said, because when I talk about the Holy Ghost, because everywhere I go, he's there. And I carry that glory. And when I talk about him, he's going to come and he's going to manifest. And you're going to get kicked out of your church. Because they already chewed you out because you went over 1 minute. Now all these people that hear when I talk about the Holy Ghost, they're going to get him. And they're going to get baptized in fire. He said, just whatever, just have your way, I think he said. So I went in him, and I began to talk about the Holy Ghost, Pastor Mark. He come in. I mean, the Holy Ghost came in. I mean, he came. I tell you, he came in every single one of them. Every single one of them. Every single one of them were hit with the Holy Ghost, baptized in fire, and I left there that night, and all 30 of them were on the floor, in a home. This wasn't a church. It was in their house, laying on the floor, laying over the couches, speaking in tongues. Now, I say all that to say this. We're carriers of His glory.
Amen.
We are carriers of His glory. God never intended for the early church, for the church to start the way it did and to fizzle out to become nothing in the 21st century. to be powerless. No miracles, no signs and wonders and motivational speaking. God never intended for the church to become that. It became that because men lost their way. They lost their way. And he no longer became first. And he has to be first. Like I said this morning, he must be first in everything. We must keep him first. His kingdom has to be first. Because you know what? If you don't get the first things right, then you won't get anything right. You know, yeah. even when it comes today, we was talking about with Sister Allie and her family member or friend, somebody plays professional baseball. You know, as you're talking about that, I didn't say anything, but I'm thinking this morning, you know, if you get somebody who plays baseball, how many play, ever play baseball? Anybody play baseball? Okay. You know what? If you take somebody who plays baseball on the World Series and they hit a infield home run, and they run the bases, and they get all the way to first, second, third, and get into home plate, and have a home run, infield home run. But you know what? If that individual who hits that ball has an infield home run, but he forgets to touch first base, second, third base, home plate means nothing because he forgot first. He forgot first. And that really, it's no longer a home run because he forgot to touch first base. So you got to have the first things first before everything else can be right. And the first things first is this. We must seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these things will be added unto us. He has to be first. No, he has to be first. No, he has to be first. No, he has to be first. And everything, he has to be first. No, and he has to be first. Because if you do not keep him first, you know what? You will find yourself doing what you want to do and not what he has for you to do. He must be first. I remember a number of years ago when I was associate pastor, I had an individual come to me and said, "Brother Richard, we're going to move. I got a raise. I'm going to make double the money, and we're going to move." I said to him, "This is like 1990. I said, "Is there a church there?" He said, "No, there's no church here, but I'm a strong Christian." I said, "Do not go." And because he asked me what I thought, so I'm going to tell him, "Do not go. Do not go." He said, "Why?" I said, "Because there's no church here." He said, "No, but you don't understand." He said, "I'm going to make double the money. I'm going to be able to buy my wife her dream home. I'm going to be able to do all the things for my kids that I want to do and get the boat and get all the things and take the vacations. It's a dream job. It's a dream position." I said, "Don't do it." "Why?" I said, "Because you're making the decision on money. And there's no church there. I don't care how strong, there's no church there where you go in this town." And you know what? He didn't listen. 3 years later, he's divorced. His 14-year-old son's on drugs, and his 16-year-old daughter's pregnant, and he's divorced. You know why? Because he didn't listen to me very closely. Because he wasn't being eternity-minded. Everything you do, every decision you make, you must make it. You must make it. Listen to me. You must make it in the light of eternity. Ask yourself the question, if I do what I'm about ready to do, how is this going to affect my eternity? And he did not do that. And his 14-year-old son's on drugs and his 16-year-old daughter's pregnant. Because he did not base the decision on eternity. It was about money. Why? Because he didn't seek first the kingdom. He sought the things. He must be first. And every decision you make, you better make it in the light of eternity. And you better make it because you've been in his presence and you've heard from him. Because if you don't, it'll be wrong. It'll be the wrong one. Hello? Listen, there's no amount of money in the world worth losing your family and them going to hell. Hello? I was preaching somewhere not long ago, and some of the people got upset with me because I said to them, I said this, I said, "You know what?" I said, "Sell your house, downsize, sell your boat, downsize, get your kids out of that godless school they're in. Get them out. Live in a smaller place that you can afford so your wife can stay home and homeschool the kids. Yeah, but we won't be able to have, we see, sell the boat and sell the house. No. No. You're thinking wrong.
Right.
You're not thinking in the light of eternity.
Right.
Hello? You're thinking everything based on money. Don't mean for it to get awful quiet in this church. But I'm telling you the truth. Every decision you make in the light of eternity, everything.
Yeah.
Every decision you make in the light of eternity. No, every decision, I don't know why I'm harping on this, because this is for some people here. Every decision you make on the light of eternity.
Amen.
No, every decision you make, you better make it in the light of eternity and ask yourself, how's this going to affect my eternity? How's this going to affect my wife's? How's this going to affect my kids?
Yeah.
Amen. See, we have to be driven by His kingdom. We have to be driven by eternity. Eternity must always be before us. Everywhere we turn is eternity. Everywhere we turn is eternity. We can't ever get away from it because it's always before us. And when you keep Him first and His kingdom first, eternity will always be before you. Amen? I can hear people's minds right now, but there's nothing this world has, absolutely nothing this world has that's worth hell. And here's the thing. Everything in this life is just temporary anyway. It's not what, listen, it's not, the things in this life is not what matters. You got your priorities wrong. The things is not what matters. That's why Jesus said, seek first His kingdom. Seek first His kingdom. And then He said in Matthew 17, love the Lord with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind. Amen?
Amen.
Everything that's within you, you love Him. Because you know what? When He's first, He's your passion.
Yeah.
No, when He's first, He is your passion. Yeah. Why is He your passion? Because you love Him. You love Him. No, you love Him. And when you love someone, you'll do whatever you have to do. Solomon loved God so much that he sacrificed 1,000 sacrifices. He didn't have to do 1,000, but why did he do 1,000? Because he loved the Lord. Because when you love someone, listen, when you love someone, first off, if you go without talking about the one you say you love, then I'm going to have to question what you love.
Right. Yeah.
Because if you really love someone as much as you say, you're going to talk about them all the time. I hear people come talking about how much they love their wife, but they don't ever talk about their wife. I question your love. Hello? Well, Brother Richard, you know, I just believe. I had somebody tell me this the other day. If I could have threw my Bible at them and smacked them, I would. But I'm sweet guy. I'm not. But I thought it. I did thunk it. I did. He said, I'm going to just take my Bible. He said to me, well, you know, Brother Richard, I just believe that faith is a private issue. I said, you know what? If Jesus would have been nailed to a cross and hung on a cross in a closet, then faith would have been a private issue. But He didn't hang on a cross in a closet. He hung on a cross. He was nailed to a cross on a hill where everybody could see it. That's why I just wanted to slap Him. We didn't even think that way. Get saved. No, but when you love someone, you talk about them all the time. Because they're your passion. No, they're your passion. That's what Jesus said. I mentioned it earlier this morning about the church of Ephesus. That's why he said to him, he said, you're doing all the things right, but yet I do have something against you. I don't know about you. I don't want the Lord to have anything against me. I want him to have absolutely nothing against me. I don't want anything to have against me. Amen? And I promise you, I promise you, listen, when you see me next year, you're going to see another man. When you see me the next year, you're going to see another man, because I am on a quest. And I have no problem telling you about it. I'm on a quest. I'm on a quest to see him face to face. I'm not talking about when I get to heaven. I'm talking about this life, because there's a whole lot more that we have to do. And what I see needs to be done, I need more than what I got right now. But here's the thing that you have to understand. In order for you to increase, because Psalms 115, where I don't know what verse it is, but Psalms 115, the Bible says that he increases us more and more. He increases us more and more. But understand something. In order for you to go to the another level, in order for you to go to the next level, understand something. There's something that is required of you. There, verse 14. Psalms 115, verse 14. There's something required of you. In order to go into the realms of God deeper than what you've gone, understand there's something required of you. And I am to the place, and I'm talking personal tonight, but I am to the place that I'm hungry and I'm so thirsty. Now, whatever it takes, whatever it takes, whatever it takes, no, whatever it takes, whatever it takes. Because my life does not belong to me. Your life does not belong to you. Your life belongs to him. Stop acting like it belongs to you. It belongs to him. You really don't have a choice. It's what he says, not what you say. It's what he wants, not what you want. Amen?
Amen.
Well, you're sounding awful radical. Oh, you ain't seen anything yet. Now, listen, I didn't get in this way overnight. But I feel it. Like I said this morning, I feel it. I hear the call. I hear the cry of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Understand, he knows all things. He knows what's ahead tomorrow. He knows what's ahead for next week. Yeah. He knows what's ahead next year. And understand something. He never lets anything take place without warning us. And he always prepares us. He always prepares us. And there's a cry. I hear the cry. Come up higher. Separate yourself. Come up higher. Come up higher, says the Lord. Come up higher. But the only way you can get there is you got to want it. And you have to be hungry. And you have to be thirsty. Because he's not going to just do it to do it. Listen, he wants you to come after him. No, he wants you to come after him. No, he wants you to come after him. But people get, well, how long is it going to take? Who cares? Just do what it is you have to do. God required Abraham's son. And I find God will always test you with a thing that means something to you. Because God wants there to be nothing in your life that's before him.
Amen.
Nothing in your life that's before him. But yet I've also know this, that when you come to the place where everything means nothing to you, then you're ready for everything. Come up higher, says the Lord. And there's no age limit to this. God doesn't look at the color of our skin. God does not look at our age. He looks at the heart. How hungry are you? How hungry are you? How hungry are you? And the only way I know for you to prove that you're that hungry is for you to be tested. people say, well, yeah, but God knew what Abraham was going to do. Yeah, but Abraham didn't know what he was going to do. Yeah, but God knows what he's going to do. Yeah, but do you know what you're going to do? It's a difference.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I know, you know, but you know, thank God not at this church, but I promise you, I've been to some churches and, you know, you're preaching right from just an open vessel as the Spirit of God speaking to you. People, well, he hadn't even opened his Bible yet. Read a scripture. We got a long time. It's no dry cleaning service. I know people think, well, oh my God, how long is he going to keep it? Well, what does that matter? If you have that thought, you're not that hungry.
Right. Right.
Because you didn't think that when you was in the world serving the devil.
That's right.
And going to the parties. Isn't it amazing? Some people serve the devil more than they serve the Lord. No, I'm serious. Because you know what? How many used to party? Raise your hand. Right. Okay, how many of you used to party, go to parties, but you don't want to raise your hand to let us know you did it? Raise your hand. Listen, I'll be honest with you. I did. That's just how I grew up. All my family drank. I did. I was in a alcohol program by the time I was 16. I remember going to the parties. I remember going to the parties and there's the alcohol and there's the kegs. And it's amazing. You know, the alcohol stops flowing, the kegs are empty, and so they pass a hat. Well, they do. Anybody been to a party and that's ever happened?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll bet. Hands keep going up slower. I know, I'm serious. I was at this one party and they passed a hat. It's amazing. Going there, everybody in the car says, well, I don't have no money. We're out of money. No, everybody was out of money. But then they passed the hat and all of a sudden enough money appears to get another cake. But nobody has no money. And you stay out until 3, 4, 5 o'clock in the morning knowing you got to go to work or go to school. But you don't care about that. Why? Because you're partaking of demonic activity because that's the nature you were of at the time and you enjoyed it. And you didn't think anything about having 2 hours sleep and going to work. But yet you'd go home, and that's people do it all the time, and they go home, wake up the next morning, a few hours sleep, wake up to some stranger beside them, wake up sick, and crawl out of the bed and crawl to the Uncle John. Because they're sick. And hug him, the toilet. That's Uncle John. Then next thing you know, then they give him an offering. And then they do, no, you're laughing because some of you did it. And then they do the same thing all over again the next night. But it's amazing. Time was an issue. But how come all of a sudden now people come and get saved and come to church and next thing you know, how long is the meeting going to go? Well, why didn't you ask that question when you were serving the devil? Let me go over to this section. This is the revival section over here. Well, how long is it going to be? Who cares? Well, what's it going to take? Who cares? Because when you're hungry, stuff like that don't mean nothing to you. Because all you can think about is, I got to know him. I got to know him. No, I got to know him. I got to know him. No, I got to know him. Listen, Moses did not go and stand in the court of Pharaoh because he heard about God. Signs and wonders didn't happen through Moses because he heard about God. Moses didn't deliver the children of Israel because he heard about God. Moses did what he did because he had a face-to-face meeting. Yes.
Hallelujah.
And that only comes because something happens on the inside of you. He becomes everything to you. It's all about His kingdom, and I got to know Him. I'm so hungry for Him. I'm so thirsty for Him. And whatever I have to do. And Abraham was willing to do whatever he had to do, even to sacrifice his own son. But it was just a test. Sometimes you have to be tested first. I know. Because before the Lord touched me, before the Lord touched me in January of 1990, my wife and I were traveling all over this country. Traveling in a little 1988 Ford Tempo. Didn't even have cruise control in it. And I couldn't even put the seats back because the car's so little and it's full of suitcases. And only one of them was mine. Let me say it over here. Only one of them was mine. And we're going all over the country. I mean, from Kentucky to California to Rhode Island to Texas to Florida to Arizona, all over this country. And I'm crying out, oh, God, I'm so hungry for You. Lord, I'm so hungry for You. Lord, You said, if I seek You, I'd find You. When I search for You with all my heart, Lord, I'm so hungry for You. I'm so hungry. I'm so hungry. Lord, I'm so hungry for You. Lord, I'm so hungry. Lord, I'm so hungry. I'm so hungry for You. Lord, I'm so hungry. Listen, one thing God will never resist is a heart that's hungry for Him. God will never resist a hungry heart. Listen to me. God will never resist. Never. He will never, absolutely never resist a heart that's hungry for Him. And I'm going all over this country. And my wife and I were back in Kentucky, and I said to Rodney, I said, where are you going next? He said, I'm going to Daytona. We had $35. And I knew at that time in 1988 or 1989, I knew that it's going to take me $50 to get to Daytona from Kentucky. Days are gone forever. But I'm going to take me $50. But I had $35. And so I said, well, when you come back through after Christmas in the new year of January 1990, because you're going to Pennsylvania, I'll just meet you there. He said, fine. After he left, the Lord spoke to me. The Lord said, I want you to go. Now, in the natural, it was stupid. In the natural, it did not make sense. In the natural, it did not make sense. Actually, in the natural, you listen to the family. I'm not being a good husband. Because I'm traveling around all over the country seeking for God, basically living in a temple. Now I'm going to go to Florida and don't even have enough money to go. That doesn't make sense. But yet I said to my wife, and thank God she never resisted. She knew. Listen, she was as hungry as I was. I said, you know what? I'll drive until we run out of gas, and we'll hitchhike. I said, we'll hitchhike. We'll hitchhike. No, we'll hitchhike. Because I'm after something. I'm after Him.
Yeah.
And I don't know Him. And I need to know Him. And whatever it takes, whatever it takes, whatever it takes. And actually, before I left, I didn't even have $35 because I went over to my grandparents' house. Because it's been so instilled into me from a kid that, you know, you change oil regularly. That's the life of your engine, change oil. So I went back in them days, you know, I could do it myself for $10. That's buy the 5 quarts of oil and the filter and everything for $10. Them days are gone forever. So I went to my grandparents' house, bought the oil and changed the oil. Now I'm down to $25. So I'm sitting in the kitchen with my grandmother, my wife and I. My grandmother said, I can still see it. It's like it was 10 minutes ago, she said, Ricky, honey, she says, you're going to Florida. Let me give you some money. I said, oh, I called her Mama. I said, Mama, no, you don't have to. She said, oh, but let me give you some money. I said, Mama, you don't really have to. I don't live my life by hints. Some people do. That's their motto. Faith without hints is dead. That's how they live. We're hitting around. I said, second time, Mama, I don't need to. She said, but I want to give you some money. So the third time, I'm like, okay, well, if you really want to, I'll take it, Mama, I'll take it. So she opened up the refrigerator. freezer. And she digs into the freezer. And she pulls out this money. And I'm like, I mean, think about cold cash. I mean, and she said to me, she says, now, Ricky, honey, don't tell your papa. This is where I keep my secret stash. And I'm like, Mama, how long have you kept that? She said, almost all of our married life. You know what? I must admit, I had the thought. I can't believe the thought come to me, but I had the thought. I'm like, you mean that's been in all this time? I'm like, man, I wish I'd have known that when I wasn't saved. I mean, I had that thought. I did. I had the thought. I know it was bad, but I had the thought. So she gave me money, and I had enough money now to get to Tampa or Daytona Beach, and there was no Cracker Barrel. Of course, I've also been told today, this since I've been with Pastor Mark, no Chick-fil-A, no In-N-Out Burger, no Cracker Barrel.
Amen.
And he told me this morning, absolutely no biscuits and gravy. I mean, there's nothing better in my way I look at it. Nice hot biscuit coming out of the oven, hot, with butter smothered all over it. A nice thick sausage, gravy, sheesh. All right, okay. Let me hook back up to the Holy Ghost here now. So we got down to Daytona Beach, and we go up there, and we're with, Rodney, and then we go down to the beach, and we're looking, and I'm sitting, and my wife's, she likes the sun, she's laying out at the beach. I'm looking out at the ocean, and I'm thinking, Lord, what is my life? Here it has been 8 months. I'm going all around the country. Nothing. I'm in these meetings when the revival Bible first broke out. I'm right in the middle of when it first broke out. I'm seeing the most incredible things. Nothing's happening to me. Everybody getting all, baptized in fire and having encounters with you. I'm just a dead preacher. So I said, I'm just a dead preacher. I said to the Lord, I don't know what fire is. I've never experienced a fire. I guess, Lord, I'm just wet wood. That's what I said to the Lord. I'm just wet wood. And as I was talking like that, I was talking just like that. Now let me show you something. As I was talking like that, all of a sudden, can I use you as an example? All of a sudden, from behind me, somebody comes up behind me and does like this. Pats me, startled me. I jump and I turn around to see who's hit me on the back. And as soon as I turn around, all of a sudden I hear these words. The Lord told me to come and tell you that you've passed the test. And he turned around and walked off. And I'm sitting like, test? I didn't even know I was being tested. I think it's the first test I really ever passed. Because all the other times when I was in school, I was there, but I wasn't there. You know what I mean? But you know what happened? No, I'm serious. You know what happened? Churaba sifre monsu. Shuguraba sifre basifra. Churaba sifre masifra. Nalabo sumre. Jelebrubo noreba sifre. Listen, you being a nation shaker has nothing to do with your secular education. It has everything to do with how hungry you are for Him and allowing Him to be first and seeking first His kingdom and allowing Him to come and baptize you in fire. Yeah. It has nothing to do with how full or here you are. It has everything to do with how full here you are. And we go up to this country church. Ha. Shabrafe ti promon chistai. Chabrubo supre bon supre pa supre pa kuta. Sabru mon sifre ba sifre and dupre mon siste. And we're not, well, actually we are. Ma celebro bon sifre ba sifre ba supre ma tita. Chamaro ba sifre. I'm sitting in the service by myself on the front, or actually I was sitting in the middle, actually, third row. And Rodney gets up and he is something different this day. The whole day was different. And he looks at me and he says, Richard, come and share with the people. First time in 8 months. So you know what I did? I shook my head and go, I don't have anything to say to these people. That's what I said. I don't have anything. Well, I didn't say these people. I said, I don't have anything to say. And he said, come, share. I'm like, I don't have anything to say. And he looks at me and he said, come here now. And everybody's just staring at me. So you know what? Honestly, I thought, okay, I'll just do whatever, the nice religious thing. I don't have anything to say to these people. I'm a dead preacher that passed the test, didn't even know he's taken. And I'm supposed to come share. What am I going to say? That's what I'm thinking in my head. I don't have anything to say. No, I'm thinking this to myself. I have nothing to say. I'm going to get up and talk, and the glory of God's going to leave. I'm a dead preacher. No, honestly, I'm just opening myself up, flaying myself tonight and telling you it just how it was. But how hungry are you? No, how hungry are you? I can promise you one thing. Don't think for one moment you coming here tonight goes unnoticed with God. Don't think for one moment, because you did not have to come here. You did not have to come. You could have stayed at the birthday party. You could have stayed at the restaurant. You could have stayed home watching whatever, the San Diego Chargers lose again. I mean, you could have just stayed home and watched all that. But you made a decision. There's something, understand something. Something caused you to come here tonight. And you know what it's called? It's called your hunger and your desire for Him.
Amen.
And I can just tell you this. When I stood up there that morning, everything changed. And I can't, well, sifre ba sifra. Everything changed. All I can tell you is the fire of God. Shista mamrusta. The frame out to shepre bon sifra. Just begin to shepre mon suste. It just began to. Jamru basifre baki sevrandusta. Just hora mandi frey basifre. Just hora dis bembre bandu bruste prepo supreende. Just bremandu prepo supre. Just like it's happening right now with many of you. Just begin to brandish your praise to Tuesday. This brange bro passe and it begin to brose bre me freine and the prane bre passande prane bre passi bre bande prane bre passi rabakene rabapande 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 rabasimbre rabapande 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 rabapande. Oh, begin to rain, begin to rain, begin to rain, begin to rain, begin to rain. How? How, Rasse? How, Brahmadu? From Brani Rubusai. Oh, Abraba Brasai. Oh, And that same fire is here right now, raining and falling on you. And all I can tell you is that my whole body was on fire, like it is right this very moment. It hasn't changed in all these many, many, many years now, 25. And begin to burn on the inside. And everywhere we have gone since that day, not one time, man, it doesn't matter if I'm at a dead church, doesn't matter if I'm with heathen. From that day to this day, every time I go somewhere, it begins to fall. And he begins to touch people. He begins to touch people. It's called the church. It's called the church.
Yeah.
It's called the church.
Yeah.
It's called the church. And God's plan, God's purpose for the church is to be baptized in fire.
Yeah.
And full of him.
Yeah.
That everywhere we go, fire flows from us.
Yeah.
Glory flows from us. The Word of God flows from us.
Yeah.
And it's not only do we love Him with all of our hearts, but we love His Word. And we hide it close to us that we might not sin against Him. We hold it close to us that we devour it, and it becomes part of us, and that when we speak, that just He flows out. Not our opinions, He flows out.
Yeah.
And we should never, don't ever treat this as an ordinary book. Don't ever treat this like some book that you pull off the shelf at Barnes & Noble, because that's man. It's nothing but man. And it's so dead that before the ink dries, it's dead. But this is the Word of God. This is the Word of the living God. This is the Word of El Shaddai. This is the Word of I Am the Almighty. That He has given it to us. Every single word, every jot, every tittle, every single word is impregnated with the very life of God. And He said, for my words are life to those who find them and medicine to all their flesh. But isn't it interesting, in order for His words to become life and medicine to all your flesh, there's something you have to do. You got to find. But you'll never find unless you're hungry and you seek. It's the Word of God. It's the Word of God. And we have to devour it. And there's absolutely no reason for us in 2015. I had to think for a moment. There's no reason for us in 2015 to be such a technology age that we are, for us to not have the Word of God constantly, 24 hours, pumped into us. From listening to it in your car as you're going to work, or as you're cleaning your house, have it playing, or as you're going to bed, have it playing. There's no excuse today. And I'm talking to myself as well. There's absolutely no excuse for us not to devour His Word. That's filled. That every single word is filled and very pregnant with His life. Every word is pregnant with His life.
Yes.
You need to be like some sponge.
Yeah.
Not some dried up sponge. No, I mean, a dried up sponge is worth nothing. It's just like a hard rock. It's worth nothing. But you take that sponge and you dip it in the water, it's so full of water that you just barely just touch it. and water diseases out. That's how we must be as Christians. We must be so full of the Word of God. We must be so full of the Holy Ghost that the moment we're touched, the moment we're pressed, His Word and His Spirit just flows from us. And everywhere we go, lives are touched. Everywhere we go, chains of bondages that are on people are broken.
Yes.
Everywhere we go, this gospel that Paul said, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. Paul was not ashamed of it, but you know, I find the closer you get to him, the less ashamed you become. People that are ashamed, and you know what? It just tells one thing. You don't know Him and you're not close to Him.
That's right.
If I'm not ashamed, woe is me if I don't preach this gospel. I long to see you, Paul said. I long to see you that I might impart unto you. It's the Word of God. Amen.
Amen.
It's the Word of God.
Amen.
And everywhere we go, it goes forth. Go into all the world and preach the gospel. It is a commandment by the head of the church, the Lord Jesus Christ. Go into all the world and preach. Go into all the world and preach. He didn't say go into all the churches. He didn't say go into all the churches. He said go into all the world. Where that means wherever there's people, we must be preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because it is the power of God unto salvation to set the captives free, to set men free. Yes. Amen?
Amen.
But he didn't just tell us to preach. He told us to cast out devils.
Amen.
Today, you know what the church wants to do today? The church wants to counsel devils. Well, come and let's have a counseling session. You can't counsel a devil. You cast it out. You cast it out. No, you cast it out. You don't listen to me. You don't even talk. You just cast. Come out. Now you come out. And the name that's above every name. Shakara. Well, show me the picture in the Bible of the church. Very easy. Acts chapter 3. Peter and John were in that upper room. As the Holy Ghost came, as the wind of God blew, as fire came and set upon them. And guess what? Months later, they're going up to the gate called Beautiful to pray. First off, that shows you that they were people of prayer. They were going up to the gate called Beautiful, and here's this man that's been laid there daily. The Bible says he'd been laid there daily. Every day he was laid at this gate, as this gate called Beautiful, as people were walking in, begging for alms to get money. That's the only thing his life meant. That's the only existence for his life, is to sit and beg and ask for money. And every day he did it. For 40 years of his life, the Bible said. But something was different this day. The church was going to pass by. The church, which Jesus is the head of, we get our orders from Him, was something different. Something was different. That's why, listen, understand something. Don't worry about where you are today, because where you are today is not where you're going to be tomorrow. Everything changes. No, absolutely everything changes.
Yeah.
And this man's life was about ready to change because the church, no, not the secret sensitive bunch, not the lukewarm bunch, the church, no, the church that's baptized in fire, the church that's full of the head of the church, the Lord Jesus, was walking by. And they have ears to hear. Because as they was walking by this day, all of a sudden, something was deposited on the inside of them from the head of the church. And all of a sudden they stopped. And the man focused his eyes on them because he's going to get some. And Peter and John, they looked upon this man, the church, you and I. You want to know what the blueprint of the church is? You want to know how we should act? Peter and John's our example. They're the church. They look upon this man who'd been laid there daily, and they said, "Silver and gold have I none." That what you're after, that what you're begging for, that what you your whole life totally exists for is not what's going to make the difference in your life. I don't have that for you. I don't have what you're after. I don't have what you're seeking. But I do got something. I do got something from my Father. I got something from heaven for you. Silver and gold, it's not what it is. But that which I have, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And they bent down and they grabbed him and they lifted him up. And the moment they did, the power of God hit this man. And he began to walk and he began to leap and he walked into the temple with him. That is what you and I are to be doing. But you can't do it empty. You can't do it fireless. You can't do it wordless. You do it because you've got this one thing right, that you seek first, His kingdom. And you're passionate about Him.
Yes.
That whatever He asks of you, you do. Why? Because you love Him. And when you love somebody, you'll do everything. You'll do anything, whatever they ask. When it comes offering time, you'll do whatever He asks of you. Why? Because of love. Because He's your passion. Amen?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I'm going to pray for people tonight. Because this morning the Lord told me to. And I quoted it here in Romans. I quoted it here in Romans. Paul said, "I long to see that I might impart it to you, that I might give to you what the Lord gave me." Understand, the gifts of the Spirit must be in operation. Not every once in a while, all the time. All the time. Listen. I'm going to share one more thing with you. I'm going to pray. Notice things I'm sharing with you, things that hadn't happened in church.
Right.
Because we got to get out of the mindset that it has to happen in church. No, we're the church. We take it with us.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah.
Because we're so full that we overflow because He increases us more and more and more.
Amen.
I went to this friend of mine's house. He came. I was in revival in this church in Tennessee. Tullahoma, Tennessee. I'm in this church, and I remember I'd go out the last night, and there's a lady sitting there in a wedding dress. I said, "What are you doing?" I could not preach without, "Why are you in your wedding dress? You just get married?" "Oh, no, I've been married for 20-some years." "Why are you in your wedding dress?" "Amazing it still fit. But why are you in your wedding dress?" Did I say that? I did. But I thought it. I'm just open. That's just how I am. I thought that. I did think that. I know I've had people say, "You share too much," but that's just me. I just lay it all out there. And I didn't say that to her. But I'm like, she said, "What's my fun dress?" I didn't know where to put it. Anyway. I don't even want to tell you that. I have no idea why I'm even telling you that. I have no idea. I have absolutely no idea why I even told you that. But I told you that to tell you this. It has nothing to do with her wedding dress. It's just that a businessman was in the meeting, And he said to me, he said, and I known the guy. As a matter of fact, we was roommates. He said, why don't you come up to our house after your revival's over with? He said, come stay with me for a few days. My daughter was little at the time. And I said, okay, so we'll come. So we go ahead. Now he said, let me ask you a question. He said, I have three roommates that are not saved. Would that bother you? I'm like, come on. He said, no, I should even ask that. I know you. And he said, that won't bother you. And so we went there and we stayed. So we're downstairs in the guy's home. Roommates aren't saved. So we're downstairs and I'm playing pool with the guy. And all of a sudden his roommate comes. He just signed a contract with Sony Records to play country music. Of course, it's in Nashville. And so he introduces me to him. And so my friend says, will you pray for him? He told me that what he's just doing. Will you pray for him? I said, sure, I'll pray. Would you like me to pray for you? He's like, and he thought about it. I had to think about it. He's like, I'll see what won't hurt. But he didn't know who was praying. So I said, oh, let me pray for you. So I grabbed his hands to pray for him, and when I did, Pastor Mark, when I prayed for him, the power of God hit him. Boom, he goes to the ground. Now, we're not in church. No praise and worship. We're playing pool. The power of God hits him. Boom, he goes to the ground. No usher again. I have lots of meetings with no ushers. And the power of God hit him. But I look at him, he's on the floor, and he starts weeping. He starts crying. I look at him, I said, what's happening to you? He said, I don't know. I've never felt this before. He said, I'm stuck. I can't get up. He said, I can't move. I said, well, that's the Lord. Just stay there. And so I just stood there just as long as he was there. And it was probably about 15 minutes. He's stuck to the floor. So he starts to move around. He's able to get up, so I help him up. And he said, what's that? I said, that's the presence of the Lord. He said, but it came from you. I said, I carry it. Because I'm the church. I said, you want to make Jesus the Lord of your life? Tears coming down his eyes. He said, I do. So I prayed with him. He invited Jesus into his heart. I said, now be filled with the Holy Ghost. Laid my hand on him. Boom. Before he hits the ground, he's speaking in tongues. Now, this probably was about 15, no, no, it was more than 15, probably about a half hour. But what I didn't know is that when he came down, the other roommate who was not saved was behind him. I just didn't see him. So he's standing behind me the whole time watching the whole thing. And after he gives his life to the Lord and gets filled with the Holy Ghost on the floor again, I actually just turned around. And when I turned around, I made eye contact with him. And when he saw me, he goes, I promise you, he did. He's not even saved. So I walked over to him. I said, do you want to make Jesus the Lord of your life? He goes, yes, I do. I said, do you want what your roommate just got? Yes, I do. So I prayed with him, and he made Jesus the Lord of his life. Laid my hand on him. Power of God hit him. Boom. There he goes to the floor, speaking in tongues. See, it's amazing how hard we religions made it, but it's very easy. Do you know God's very, very easy, very simple? You know how simple it is? All things are possible to him that believes. It's that simple. You know how simple it is? Whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. You know how simple it is? Seek me and search for me with all your heart and you'll find me.
Yes.
So we go upstairs. We go up. They're totally drunk in the Holy Ghost. We get up, we're sitting in the living room, and all of a sudden, I don't know, sometime later, and we're all, my daughter, my wife, and all of us just enjoying the presence of the Lord, drunk and rolling on the floor and laughing uncontrollably. The third roommate walks in. The third roommate, he opens the door, he walks in, and he stops, and he freezes. And he looks, and he steps back out and looks at the address on the house to see if he got the right address. And then he knew he was right. He walks in, and he's walking in slowly. And he's walking in, looking at all. So the one guy, the second guy I prayed for, he jumps up and he comes and he grabs him by the arm and he pulls him over to me and stands in front of me and he says, now do to him what you did to us. You know what? He gave his life to the Lord Jesus. He got baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. And the one guy, I just found out 2 years ago that the one guy actually, he stopped playing country music and he ended up, came somewhere here in California to go to seminary, and he just graduated and has become a pastor. Wow. Understand something. Everywhere we go, we're to leave our mark.
Amen.
We don't leave people thinking all is okay, that God understands. We don't leave people with, you know, the Lord knows your struggle. You're battling with what? Drug addiction? You want to be free? Oh, yeah, I want to be. Okay, stand up right now. Stand up right now. Huh? Stand up right now. In the name of Jesus, come out of him. Lay hands on him. Boom, power of God hits him. Then you get him up. Now make Jesus the Lord of your life.
Amen.
That's how simple it is. See, understand, it's easy when you're filled. It's easy when he's first. But it's hard when you're empty. Because then it's all you doing it. And you can't do nothing. No, you can't do nothing. There's nothing you can do in the flesh to help anybody. Nothing. There's nothing you can do in the flesh. There's absolutely nothing you can do in the flesh to help anybody.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I'm going to share one more thing. Can I share one more thing?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. That is my meeting. You know, it's like that song, "This is my meeting, I'll do what I want to, do what I want to." I'm at this church. The Lord wants me to share this, and I'm going to pray. We got to do what he wants. Amen?
Amen.
I'm invited to go to this church. The pastor's been trying to get me to come for a while, and I had something postponed. I called this pastor. I said, "Look, I can come to your church and start this Sunday." He said, "But it's Wednesday." I said, "But I can start this Sunday." "You can't come any other time." I said, "No, I can come this Sunday." He said, "Well, okay, come, and we'll just get the word out." So I go to the church. I walk in, first off, I'll be honest with you, it's the ugliest church I think I've ever seen in my life. It's out in the country, so I was in a meeting in a pole barn. The walls were just ugly. I mean, an ugly green. Just not like your shirt. Ugly. I mean, just, I'm teasing. It's not like your shirt. I was just seeing if he's still paying attention. He was. And the seats were just ugly. I mean, the vinyl, ugly. And the carpet was like from people's homes. That they just, whatever, it was just ugly. It was an ugly church. There's like 60 people in it, just ugly. And the praise and worship was, oh, Jesus. I even think about it now. Just, listen, I can't sing. I cannot sing. I can't even sing in the shower. I can't sing. I can't carry a tune. But I know when somebody can and when somebody can't. And they can't. No, it was bad. Like one preacher said, I could have done a better job with the cat under my arm squeezing it. I mean, it was bad. It's bad. Now, listen. So it was so bad. Now, you know it's bad when the guy playing the guitar has got the stickers on the neck. Okay, A. No, I'm serious. I'm serious. He had the stickers on the keyboard. The keyboard player, the keys had the stickers. What was A and C and B, and there wasn't no flow. It's bang. I'm like, oh, my gosh. Listen, I promise you, it was that bad. I'm not exaggerating. I don't ever exaggerate. I stepped outside. I said, oh, my God, I can't handle this. I can't handle that. I can't handle that. I can't handle that. I can't. There's nothing. There's more anointing on Linda Skinner. I mean, there's nothing. I mean, there's nothing.
That's right.
I mean, it was bad. Now, don't go say I gave people the license to listen to Linda Skinner. I didn't. But I'm like, oh, my God. I said to the Lord as I'm standing outside, Ruth, I said, Lord, I know, Lord, You can preach it down and pray it down and worship it down. Won't be no worshiping down your glory in this church this week. I said, Lord, you're going to have to help me. As soon as I said that, the pastor walked out and shut the door behind him, and he looks at me, makes eye contact with me, and he said, "Oh, Brother Richard, I can't handle that in there." That's the pastor of the church. The pastor of the church. He said, "I can't handle that worship. Oh, my God, you got to agree with me. God, send me some worshipers, because that's not even a noise." No, that's the pastor. So here's the pastor and the evangelist outside because the worship was bad. So I go by afterwards. We go back in. He does, all the church preliminaries and stuff. So he has me get up. As soon as I get up behind the pulpit, there's a lady sitting on the front. And she's looking at me. And she's giving me these looks. Mad, mean looks. And she's just looking. She's not even blinking. She's looking. And I'd come, well, do like I do, walking up, and I would walk by her, and she'd look at me and go, I'm serious. She would growl at me. And she's sitting on the front row, and she'd growl. But her eyes would just fall on me. I'm serious. I've never had that happen before or since, but she growled at me. And I'm like, "Lord, am I supposed to cast this devil out?" And the same thing to me, so I just left it. I thought, and I said, "Well, she won't be back tonight." She came back that night, sitting on the front row. And she did the same thing. Look at me and just... She growled. And I'm thinking, she won't be back Monday. Monday night she came. Growled on Monday night. She growled Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Monday night. She growled. It's Tuesday night she comes back. She growled again. But I look in her eyes and all I could see is pain. Come to find out, because I asked the pastor about it. I said, "Who's that lady? She's growling at me. She's full of the devil." He said, "Oh, yeah, but it's her property. It's her pole barn that we meet in. It's her and her husband's." But that night, the Lord said to me, "Share your testimony, the whole thing." I didn't even share the whole thing tonight. And I began to share the whole thing. And when I did, the same thing happened that happened 25 years ago. The fire of God fell. And all of a sudden, I felt it come and go swoosh. It like came on me and whoosh, hit her. And she screamed. The lady, I heard this hellish scream. And it seemed like she screamed for 10 minutes nonstop. Wasn't that long, but it seemed that long. But all of a sudden, when she stopped screaming, all of a sudden, she starts laughing uncontrollably. She starts laughing. But this time, it was a laugh of freedom. It was a laugh that comes from heaven. And she hits the floor, and she laughed uncontrollably, rolled around on the floor, rolling. The people, they're coming. Stop watching and enjoy and get in yourself. Stop watching. Why is she rolling? It's called Pentecost. Where the holy roller term comes from. That's Pentecost. Did you know for 3 hours she rolled and laughed nonstop for 3 hours? Listen, the husband picked her up, put her over his shoulder like a sack of potatoes, and carried her into the house and flopped her, Elizabeth, flopped her on the bed. And he went to bed with her. He said for the next few hours, I said, this is like this in bed. He said, and my wife laughed uncontrollably, Pastor, laughed uncontrollably. He said, I had to get up at 5:30 in the morning to go to work. He's the welder. I got to go to work. So he went and slept in the next room. He said, when he woke up at 5:30 in the morning, he heard, the first thing he heard, his wife was still laughing uncontrollably. And I asked the pastor about him. He said, the pastor, this woman, and he said, nobody likes her. They hate this woman. She's so mean. I know, she growled at me. He said, he called home, the husband called home for lunch. He and the kids answered, said, Daddy, what's happened to Mama? She's still laying in bed from last night, still got her church clothes on, laughing. Still laughing, Mom. Daddy, she won't stop. We go in there and shake her, and she don't stop. She's just laughing. They said, leave her alone. He comes home that night. Just enough time to get him a sandwich. He walks in the door. His wife's still laughing. Still laying in the same position from the night before where he flopped her in the bed in the church clothes. He made him a sandwich, and he goes in, picks her up, throws her over his shoulder like a sack of potatoes, and carries her into the church and flopped her back down. He carried her out that night. The next night he carried her in. But you know what? Here's what happened. This lady, demons left her. This lady had tried to commit suicide many times. She's been in and out of mental institutions. She's on 20-some different medicines. From the time that she was 8 years old to the time she was 14, her father, her brother, her uncle, and her grandfather would just do wicked things to her. They took her out in the country in the caboose and would put her in that caboose and just do nothing. But I'm not even going to tell you what they did. Just wicked stuff to this girl. From the time she was 8 years old to the time she was 14. Just full of hell. Just full of hell. But you know what? She was totally set free. Totally. Totally set free. I even looked at her. Her face was different. It was not even the same one. People in the church was remarking about, is that really her? It's not her. It's a totally different woman. Do you know 6 months later she became the worship leader of the church? But what happened? Just some Kentucky boy, full of the Holy Ghost, that seeks first his kingdom, that only wants what he wants, to allow him to flow and move and do whatever he wants to do in the meeting, came and he touched this woman. The chains and shackles of hell were broken off of her. She was totally set free. Matter of fact, just a couple months ago, I was in Georgia, and she commented on the meetings in Georgia that we were having. She's still free to this day.
Amen. Hallelujah. That's what we live for.
It's the church.
Amen.
No, that's the church.
Yes.
No, it's called the church.
Yes.
It's called the church.
Yes.
No, see, understand, we have the answer. And listen, make no mistake about it. The world is crying out for the sons of God to come forth. The world is crying out for the true church that has not compromised, that is not corrupt, that is not going to bow their knee to the world, but we're only consumed with Jesus, consumed with the Father, consumed with the Holy Ghost, consumed with His kingdom, that's laid their life on the altar. Do whatever you want to do, Lord. The world's crying out for the church to come forth. Are you going to be one of those ones? Are you going to be the church? Are you going to be the church? Are you going to be the church that allows Him to move freely through you anywhere?
Yes, Father.
Shabrabandi frey pasita. Shete frey hasi frey pakita. Sebre ma ruf sebre basifa. Sembre bo supre po ruf tele bakita. Rebo supre mo drubandi pre hasita. Lele bo bo pa hande heri ba. I hear the Holy Ghost saying, are you going to be the one? Are you going to be the one that will allow me to come and burn with fire? Are you going to be the one that will allow me to flow with my purpose through you? Shake it, Rabbi Sapra. Say Rabbi Rapa. Rara Rabbi Sapra. Nara Rapa Ria Rapa. Hala Rabbi Sale la Mundela. Hala Rabandela Rabosunda la Rabosatai. Hala Rabandela Rabosora. I tell you, right now, the fire of God's raining. Right now, the fire of God, because he heard your yes. He's raining right now. He heard you say yes. He's heard you say yes. He's heard you say yes. He's heard you say yes. And tonight you leave with an impartation from heaven. Tonight you leave with the working of miracles. Tonight you leave with the gift of faith. Tonight you leave with an anointing from heaven. Increase. 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 More and more. 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 And more and more. And more. The Lord says, tell abiding place, there is no end. There is no end. There is no limit, because I increase more and more. There's no ending. I increase more and more. I increase more and more. You'll never come to the place where you arrive, because as long as you keep Him first and obey the Father and do His will, He will increase you more and more and more and more and more. With finances, He will increase you more and more and more and more and more. But when's enough, Lord? There is no end, because He only knows one thing: more and 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 more. More and more and more and more and more and more and more.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
When's enough's enough? That's not even in God's vocabulary. The only thing God can think is more and more and more and more and more. More and 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 more. That's who he is. Now that's who he is. Now that's who he is. That's who he is. Now that's who he is. Now that's who he is. No, that's who he is.
Hallelujah.
No, that's who he is.
See, even thinking the terms when's enough's enough is to just reveal that you don't really understand who he is.
Ha 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 ha. Ha 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 ha. Ha 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 ha.
Even talk or think in terms of lack shows that you really do not have an understanding of who your Father is. Because there's absolutely no lack in him. Because he just does one thing. More and 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 more. I tell you, the gift of faith, drop it in here right now. The gift of faith, drop it in here right now. The gift of faith, drop it. The gift of faith. I just heard the Lord say, tell the people that the gift of faith that was imparted unto Ali is the same gift of faith I'm imparting to people right now in the name of Jesus. Take it now. More and more and more and more and more and more and more. And a year from now, you'll testify. Oh, more and more and more and more and more. Receive it now in Jesus' name. I hear the Holy Ghost more, 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 and more, more, and more, more, and more, more, and more. More and more, more and more, more and more and more. See, how can there be a limit to the one who has no beginning and no end? Because everything that comes from him, because he's limitless, everything that comes from him is limitless. Oh, Sakara! 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 Hopa! Ha ha! I tell you, the fire of God's all over. Ha 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 ha! Fire of God's mom, Rubani di Vre Basita. Ha ha! So, bro, I'm on Rubasi Vre Basifra. Ho bra pati pre pakita. Ha ha ha. 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 Zoom, 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 Zomba. Oh, Zabababa. Oh, Zabababa. Oh, Zabababa. In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. Oh, Rabababa. Oh, Brabababa. See, when you get with him, you don't listen, when you get with him, you don't think in terms of lack.
Nah,
you can't, because there's no lack in him.
Because he has no lack. Because he has no beginning. He has no end. He's always been. He's limitless. And if we just learn to hook up with him, our lives will become a life where we do limitless things. And we walk in the realm of limitless. But the world even comes and say, how, my father? But how, my father? But how, my father? Just like a shepherd. Oh, yeah. That's the fire of heaven. Yeah, that's the fire of heaven. No, that's the fire of God. See, really, I don't have to pray for you, really, to be honest with you. I don't have to lay hands on everybody tonight because he's here walking up and down the aisle right now. Because the angels of God are here. He's here right now handing out the gifts. Just take it. No, yeah, but I can see people right now. I can see people right now. I can see it right now. I can see it being deposited right now. More and more. Tell me about your father. Okay, more and more. Ha. Sebri busta. Harabatita. I'll tell you, sister, that's a fire of God all over you. I see it all over the place. That's a fire of God, sister, all over you. That's a fire of God all over you. That's a fire of God all over you. That's a sister. That's a fire of God all over you. I see it all over this house. I see it all, even right here in the back. Oh, there's no limit to him. Oh, I see all my brain. I see it right now. I see it. I don't have to do. He's doing it. He's here right now. Zele, zabrabane, kisaya busu bayanzu bokuta. Cerebo supra partisha. Supra. Ha ha ha. Oh, you know what? In the time, I can't do it now, but we're going to do something else in a minute. But don't get out of this because God's not done. Stay. Oh, you want to know about him? More and more. You want to know about him? Super abundantly above all that you could ever ask or think. More and more. Jesus brought passi breta. More babedili brebosi preese breba papa. Nale ruborreba niti pasai. Ha 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 ha
Never the sister right here will never be the same. This girl right here, never be the same. Never be the same. You'll never be the same. You throw three. I tell you, the fire of God's on these three right here. I see it on a lot of people, but I'd never the same. Never the same. Never the same. Never the same. Now, I tell you, right now, you know what? Disease is leaving people right now. Disease is leaving people right now. Sickness and disease is left. It's 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 left. It can't be in His presence. Ha ha. Can't be in His presence. Ha ha ha. Can't be by Rafidi Abrabahasi. Ha 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 ha. Yeah. Sombra Eribosu Tari Brusabri and Orabakita. Ha 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 ha. Mama mama. Oh yeah. No mama. No mama. No mama. That heart problem that concerned you is gone. And that stomach issue is gone. Ha ha. Okay, I'm going to do this. I'm just waiting for the right time. Hallelujah. Because there's something else that the Lord wants to do. We're going to do it right this second, right now. Hallelujah. We're just going to give you an opportunity right now to sow a seed in the ministry.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
That's all I'm going to say about it. You just obey the Lord. 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 Just obey the Lord. You just obey the Lord. Just obey the Lord. Just obey the Lord. But there's a bunch. Well, this we're not near done. I hear those words more and more and more. I had more. The Lord just gave me that scripture tonight. Ha ha. Maribo supre. Maribo supre and upopo supre. Ha 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 ha. Mariba papa. Nelele papati. Ha. See, when you get with Him, it's impossible to think lack. When you get with Him, it's impossible to think impossibilities. You know, here some time ago, religious people got mad because one of the preachers talked about getting a $65 million jet. Well, if they really understood their father, they would have think one, you should get three. He's endless. There's no end to Him. It's just the people that get an attitude just don't understand who their father is. They understand. Listen, when you understand Him, when you get with Him, when you understand who He is, you'll never again talk lack. You'll never even think lack. Only thing you can do is think what He is, and He's abundance. He's more than enough. He's more and more and more and more and more. What just wins enough, enough? There's no such thing. Because only thing God knows is more and more and more and more. That's all He knows. More and 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 no more. And just when it's enough, Allie, there is nothing saying is there is enough. More and 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 more 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 and more 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 and more 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 more. See. I hear this in the spirit. And I'm sure it's for more than one because you could take a word and apply it to yourself. But I just heard this. Somebody's business here is about ready to explode.
You're busy because you've been struggling, but you haven't quit. But you're about ready to, I'm telling you, about ready to explode. Ha! Oh, I can say a whole much more about it. Mama, momo, mama. More and more and more. More and more and more and more. More and more and more. More and more and more and more and more. Sa. Ha. How are we going to do this now? Okay. Father, in the name of Jesus, more and more and more and more and more. Oh, Rabatita. Jesus, more and more and more. Rabba piti tati susta. Ha ha ha. Ha 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 ha. Lele le ba heita. Ha 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 ha. Ha 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 ha. Maba, reba, raba sipa. Ma 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 dita. Ha ha. Pastor, I just, true, more and more. You know, I don't have the words. I just know what I feel the Spirit of the Lord saying, that He's heard our conversation. He's heard our conversation. He's heard our conversation. And He will not withhold Himself to us.
Amen. Jesus. My Lord.
I'm just going to do just a few things I saw, okay? I want you, and 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 you, and the sister, where's she? There you are, and you, yes, you, and you, and you, yes, yes, you, yeah, right here, you. Yes, you. Ha ha ha. Ha ha ha. And I want you. Ha ha ha. And I want you. Ha ha. And I want you. Ha ha ha. And I want you. Ha ha ha. And I want you. I'm just now. I stopped there because. More and stand. Those of you I pointed, come stand.
More and more.
Now, the only reason I stopped there is because I don't have no more room. So just line up.
More and more.
Why not? We're going to come to you. Yeah, don't feel left out because I'm coming to you. No. Line. Line. Ushers, I need to help me with a line. Ha 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 ha. Ha ha ha. Oh, yeah. Sister.
More
and more. Oh, ho. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
That's fire. That's fire. That's fire. Oh, yeah. That's fire. Oh, yeah. That's fire. That's fire. Sister, yeah. Come. More and more.
More.
Oh,
Same. I'll stay right here so the camera.
More for you, says the Lord. More. Yes, yes.
Oh, come up here. More.
More for you today.
More.
More and than more. You could
and
ever
more.
Contain.
And more. And more. And more. It's the power of God. I saw you behind the camera, but you was hiding behind the camera. Not hiding purposely, but couldn't see your face, but I saw the fire of God come on you, and I saw it come on you as you're sitting. What's your name? Sarah. And what's your name? Sarah and Clara. Ha ha ha. What's your handorabahata? More and more and more, mama.
Sarah and Clara. More and more and more and more. Abundantly more and more and more. Sarah and Clara. More and more. Abundantly more. Increasingly more.
Vanessa, Clara. Oh, Clara. Oh, Sarah. Oh, Riley, little boy. Did I pray for you? Did I pray for you? Come. We'll put you right here. Oh, Rabari, Arati. She says, Mommy, I got to get up here. How old are you, sweetheart? You're six. What's your name?
Georgie.
That's your daughter? She told her mama, she's six. She said, Mama, I just got to get up there. Can you stand right here, buddy? Lift your hands. Close your eyes. Lord Jesus, use her to touch her generation. Use her, Lord, to shake her generation. Use your Lord, the fire. Never the same, Mom. Fire. Jesus. Fire. More and more and more. Yeah. Of the Holy Ghost. Oh, Rabadi, Rabadi. Israel, trust thou in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. O house of Aaron, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. Ye that fear the Lord, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. The Lord hath been mindful of us. He will bless us. He will bless the house of Israel. He will bless the house of Aaron. He will, listen, he will bless them that fear the Lord, both small and great. The Lord shall increase you more and more, you and your children. Yes, sir. You know, there's no end to these meetings. We love you dearly. I'm already excited about when we come back. Pray for us. The first of the year, we're getting ready to go on TV nationwide, because it's time that people turn on the TV
and stop seeing the garbage. Stop seeing the manipulation. Stop seeing those that are only about money and see that which is real. Amen. The church. And that's what we're going to show on TV. If you've got DirecTV, it'll be channel 336. I don't know the other channels. We'll let you know. We love you dearly. Service is not over. I'm just letting you know. I love you. We love you, Pastor. We'll see you next time. Hallelujah.
Everybody stand with me and sing, Lord, I want more. I want more. I want more. Desperately more. I want more. More and more. I want more. Oh, God, please more. I want more. Desperately more. I want more. More and more. I want more. Oh God, more. I want more and more and more. I want more. Oh, desperately more. I want more. The limitless more. I want more. More and more. I want more and more of you. I want more. More and more. I want more and more and more. I want more. Desperately more. I want more. The limitless more. I want more. More and more. Just lift your hands. I want more. More and more. I want more. More and more, I want more of you.
Just understand that the Spirit of the Lord is speaking to you. Just understand that these aren't the words which men have manufactured and ideas that have come out of the thinking realm of men. But this is those things that the Spirit of the Lord is saying. And if we respond to him in confidence that what he said, he's also able to do. What he's declared, the word that has gone forth, he watches over to hasten it. Huh. Then you can step into a more right now, tonight. You step into a more that you begin to live out tomorrow. And then the hunger and the thirst and the desperation for the more just continues to increase. Don't delay. Don't be stuck in doubt. Don't be stuck in yesterday. Don't in any way measure what God is going to do tomorrow based upon what's happened, because he has the limitless more. He's calling us into a whole realm beyond anything that we've ever found, beyond anything that we've ever known. God causes us to come, and he calls us to come to increase with the increase of God, the increase of his manifest glory in Avalon. You'll find me saying this. You'll just find me going, oh, I want more, more and more. I want more, desperately more. I want more, more and more. The limitless more of you. Oh, I want more, more and more. I want more, desperately more. I want more. More and more, the limitless more of you. Find a bunch of people around you. Hug them, tell them that you love them. Bless them in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. People, let me just tell you, we walk in this effortlessly, obediently, confidently. No struggle. It's just a glorious rest. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth that you find this place of the overflowing glory of God. We're just so filled up all the time and still being willing in the state of being filled up to be filled more. Woo-hoo! Woo-hoo! Yeah. Just find a bunch of people. Just grab a hold of them, hug them. Come on, do it now. Grab them, hug them, and bless them. Tell them, "Sanctify your time more in Jesus' name."
just more of you. Oh, I want more, more and more. I want more, desperately more. I want more, more and more. The limitless more of you. Oh, I want more, more and more. I want more, desperately more. I want more, more and more. The limitless more of you. Oh, I want more, more and more. I want more, more and more. I want more, more and more. The limitless more of you. Desperately more.
Woo! Yeah, that's it. All the glory in the communion. All the glory in the fellowship. All the glory. All the glory. All the limitless glory.
More and more. I want more, the Lord, of you. Oh, I want more, more of you. Desperately more, I want more, more and more. I want more, the limitless more. I want more, more and more. I want more, desperately more.